Hey, welcome to the shop. Today I'm going to show you how to weld with Flux Core. We're going to go everything from setting up your machine, your welding technique, and I'm going to show you a special bonus technique at the end that'll let you stack some dimes, and I actually broke my vise in half trying to test it. You're not going to want to miss that, so stick around. Let's get started. Now, Flux Cored welding is really cool because like any welding process, you have to protect your molten metal from the atmosphere and the air because the elements in the air like oxygen will react with your weld pool and just make a mess. So instead of using a gas that comes out of a bottle around it, you actually use a flux that's in the middle of a metal tube, and that's what your wire is made out of. So it both adds additional metal into your weld and adds that flux to perform a chemical reaction and protect your molten metal from the air. I'll just mention that in some industrial processes, they have wires that will actually run with a shielding gas as well. But today we're focused on self-shielded flux core wire because I think that's gonna be most helpful to everybody out there who's working as a hobbyist or maintenance worker, those types of things. I'm gonna be using this blue demon wire, and I think it works better than some wires I've used in the past. But you can definitely experiment with different brands yourself. One thing you're going to want to look at is in the literature that comes with it or the information on their website is whether you can run multiple passes or not. I'll just give you a warning that a lot of them can only run a single pass. That's the case with this wire here. So just look and make sure it'll work with what you're doing. Now let's go ahead and load some wire into the machine. I'm going to load it up on the titanium Flux 125 from Harbor Freight first, and then I'll show you some of the differences when you're loading it on a machine that's a dedicated MIG welder like this Multimatic. We're gonna be using those two machines here today. So the first thing you need to do is just drop your wire roll onto the spindle, and then we're gonna need to make sure that your drive roll is set to the right notch. Now the drive roll is like a tire that pushes your wire out, and they usually have multiple grooves and they're labeled with the size of wire that they'll work with. Let's go ahead and feed our wire through the guide, past the drive roll, and into our liner. And now once it's in there, we can clamp down the idler and start feeding it through. Now one last thing before we feed our wire all the way up this lead, we need to remove the contact tip, which is this copper piece at the end, and it is what conducts electricity from a wire inside the lead to your actual wire that comes out. Now, by the way, these have a number written on them that indicates the size of wire they work with. Make sure you're using the contact tip that matches your wire diameter. Now, once that's removed, we can pull this lead out straight, hold the trigger down, or hold your feed button, and that'll push some wire up and out. Then we can thread the contact tip on the end and tighten it up, and we're in pretty good shape to weld. Now, one last thing, you can adjust the tension on your drive roll idler by taking a scrap block of wood, coming in at it at like a 45 degree angle like this, feeding some wire to make sure that drive roll doesn't slip. If you're getting any slippage, you're gonna wanna tighten that idler up. If you're not getting any at all, you might be able to loosen it a little bit, but anyway, that's a way to dial that in. Okay, let's take a look at some of the differences on this dedicated MIG welder here. So when I open the hood up here, you can see that this spool won't even fit on because it's set up to run a larger spool. I just need to remove this adapter, then I can install that spool and thread it through the same way. I've got that drive roll that I've set to the right groove there, and now I can feed it out the end. But before I can remove my contact tip to feed it out, I also have a gas nozzle that I need to remove, and then I can get to my contact tip. Now, some MIG welders will have a different attachment you can put on for flux cord welding rather than the nozzle, and some will just run the regular nozzle. That's what we're gonna be doing here today. And there's one last thing that we need to address with a dedicated MIG welder, and that is our polarity. Polarity is a word that refers to whether your torch or your ground clamp are connected to positive or negative. So if you're welding with solid wire, you'll typically want your gun connected to the positive side of the circuit, where if you're welding with self-shielded flux core wire, you'll usually want it connected to the negative side of the circuit. And so on the front of this Miller Multimatic, I can just switch these cables, and that's a pretty common arrangement today. You can just do it without tools, but in some cases you may need to open the lid and there might be terminals that you need to switch. Now let's go ahead and look at our settings. Now settings aren't gonna have as big of an effect as technique will, but you need to be in the ballpark. There's two main settings on a wire feed process like this. One is the speed at which your wire comes out, and the other is your voltage. And these need to be set so that they work well together. Now, if these are both set high, you know, higher wire feed speed, you'll typically need a little bit higher voltage, and that's going to give you more heat and penetration. It will also result in more amperage coming out. Now, if you set them both lower, that's gonna work better for thinner material. If you go to the chart on your machine, that'll show you where to set them for a given thickness of material. Almost every machine has a chart that'll show you that. And it's best to just start off with that until you get your technique down, then you can dial these in a little bit. I'll just show you a couple of things that can happen if your settings are way out of whack. Now, if your voltage is really low for the wire speed that you have, you might have your wire actually stub out and jam into your material, and you can feel this through the gun a lot of times, and your arc will go out like that. You'll have a similar arc effect where it's going out if your voltage is way too high for your wire feed speed, and your wire actually burns back from the material. And then it can go out like that. So look for those warning signs that something is out of whack. But other than that, the recommended settings will usually work well enough to get started. Now let's talk technique. This is what's gonna make the biggest difference for you. And there are three things that matter. Your stick out, that's how far your wire's sticking out, or the distance between your contact tip and your work. Your angle that you're holding your gun to, and your movement, how you move it along. Those three things are really all that matters when it comes to technique. So we're going to go through each one of them and talk about how to be successful with it. Your stick out is pretty easy to explain, but often difficult to do. Now, in most cases, what you're gonna need is about a half inch or 13 millimeters between your contact tip and your work on flux core. This can vary a little bit, but you'll want to be consistent with whatever you're doing. So that comes down to just holding it at a consistent distance. Try this a little bit just with the machine turned off on the table. See if you can hold it there. The next thing is your angle. Now there's two different angles to look at. One is your travel angle in the direction that you're moving. Now it's a good practice with flux cored welding like this to use a drag angle. Though there is some, you know, some leeway with most of these self-shielded processes. But anyway, if I drag by just about 10 or 15 degrees and try to keep that consistent along here. What's really important though is your work angle going in and out of your plate. So if I have two plates that are welded together here, I'm gonna wanna go straight in and out of them. Where if I have plates that are welded together at an angle, I'll go 45 degrees into that angle in this direction. So that's what you need to do when it comes to your angles. Next is your movement. The most important thing is to move along at a nice, consistent speed. Now, the way that you determine the right speed to weld is by the size of your weld. So you watch that weld puddle as you weld along. If you're welding too slow, it'll be too wide. If you're welding too fast, it'll typically be too narrow. Right, so you're just watching that weld pool to determine your speed. Now, as far as manipulation goes, you might use a little bit of a weave back and forth, but I wouldn't get carried away with it, right? So I'll weave just a little bit, and that helps me to stay in the center as I move along, but I'm just staying, you know, pretty well in the front edge of the weld pool. Now let's go ahead and run some practice beads once you're feeling pretty good about being able to hold your distance, your angle, and your movement without welding. We'll put the hood down and start running beads. And this is what I would do is I'd just get a flat plate of test metal. Could be the side of a tube, whatever you've got. Anyway, weld along. And you know, as you weld, you'll wanna see each bead getting better every time. Now, when you do this, pay attention to one thing at a time as you weld along. First, pay attention to your stick out until you're feeling pretty good about that. Then pay attention to your angle and pay attention to your movement. Make sure you're moving consistently along. Let me give you a tip that's gonna make this a little bit easier to maintain those things, and that is how to get comfortable. So there's a few different ways that I like to prop with my other hand that I'm not welding with. One, if I'm welding on the bench, I'll put my hand vertical, set the gun on there, and then I can just move along consistently. Another is I'll put my elbow, and this is more common when I'm welding actual stuff because you can't always just slide along. Sometimes you can. Anyway, I'll put my elbow against something like this, grab on here with my other hand, and just triangulate it, right? And so that just helps me to stay consistent. Now, if you can't do this and you have to weld with one hand, just tuck your elbow in tight so fewer joints can move around. Use your other hand to steady yourself, and then just work your way along. and you'll be able to do okay. Anyway, stick out, angle, movement. I'm gonna repeat that over and over again. You're gonna be annoyed today, but you're gonna thank me tomorrow when you remember it. Let's move on to an actual joint. This is a T-joint, and the first thing that we're gonna need to do as we start welding things together is to tack weld. Now, in order to tack weld, I just start welding on one piece, rock over to the other side. Sometimes I have to rock back and forth a little bit, but you wanna see that metal bridge between both without having it get too large. You end up with something like this. I'll tack both ends and get lined up. A few dry runs just to make sure that I've got my angle, my movement, I can make it all the way across. And then let's go ahead and weld. So as I move along, I'm just focused on those things. I'm focused on my stick out, my angle, my movement, and I'm watching that weld pool to make sure that it moves along just with a nice consistent size and speed. And as I make it all the way along here to the edge, let's clear some of that slag and take a look. While the weld looks pretty good, it's a good idea to test your welds out and see what you've got. Now, a good way to do this is to weld just on one side of a T-joint like this, and then I'll clamp it in the vise, and I'm actually gonna bend it over and see if it breaks apart or if it'll bend over. Now, in this case, you know, I'm having to work on it pretty hard. I can tell this is pretty strong. I'm happy with this for this weld I made with this Harbor Freight machine. But anyway, you might have your weld break apart. Now that has to do more with the thickness of your plate relative to the size of your fillet weld than it does with the quality of your weld. But if it does break apart, what you want to look for is see if the bottom of that plate is still intact or if it got consumed. Now, just for good measure, let's go ahead and run that same joint with the Miller Multimatic. Now, in this case, you can tell it's running a little bit hotter. I'm able to move a little bit faster and there's less spatter. So it definitely runs better, which I'd expect it to for a machine that costs about 10 times as much. However, you know, I'm getting a pretty good result with both. So as I finish up, I'll clear the slag off here and I feel pretty good about that weld also. So anyway, whatever you've got, you know, make the most of it. Next, let's go ahead and weld together some square tubing using this Harbor Freight machine. Now, square tubing is the material that I use the most to actually fabricate things. And so I just took a couple of scraps that I have laying around here. This is 16 gauge, which is 1/16 of an inch thick or 1.5 millimeters. Now, I've had to turn my settings down a little bit on the machine, but in the exercises that we've run so far, running those beads on plate, welding together the T-joints, we've done everything we need to do to be able to weld this joint together. So I'll go ahead and tack it together, just like we did on the T-joint, and then I'll run along the face here, and I'll do that just like we did the bead on plate, and then run this fillet weld here, just like we did the T-joint. And it came out pretty good. I did notice that my settings felt a little hot to me, so I went ahead and turned the machine down just a little bit on my wire speed as well as my voltage, and ran it again on a couple other pieces that I had laying around, and I got a result that's even a little bit better. So there's everything that you need to start actually fabricating some stuff. Next, let's look at a bonus technique that you can use to get kind of a stack of dimes appearance, right? So that rippled appearance that you'd see in a weld. Now, let me just note that having that rippled appearance doesn't necessarily mean that it's a good weld. It doesn't necessarily mean it's a bad weld either. But you know, there are a lot of traps in the ways that you try to run these that can give you something with a little bit less strength. So just be a little cautious. Let's go ahead and run this weld here. So I'm just doing this between these quarter inch plates, and I've turned this machine up. Now let me just note that this is running beyond the capacity that this machine is rated to. It's shown to weld up to 3/16 of an inch, and I'm welding a quarter of an inch, which is over it by about 1.5 millimeters or 1/16 of an inch. Now, as I work my way along here, I'm just tracing these T's by going forward down into the root of the joint, then coming back and crossing the T up and down. And each time I do that, it creates a ripple in the weld. And so when I'm all done and I clear the slag, I have that nice stack of dimes appearance. Now, I'm skeptical of the strength of this particular weld, though I think it'll be good for a lot of things. But probably not good for everything. But anyway, I'll go ahead and put it here in my vise to test it. Hit it with the hammer and oh, the vise broke right in half. So I've got to have some amount of strength there. I'm not sure. Either way, we'll have to check this in a different way. I actually like the fillet weld break test because it gives you a look along the whole length of the weld, but we'll just cut and take what's called a cross section. So I'll cut this weld down through the middle here. and then take and polish down a little bit of material. And then I'll put on some alcohol mixed with nitric acid. This isn't necessarily something to have at home and do, but anyway, I can see where the weld metal is relative to the base metal, because this will actually corrode the weld metal differently and give it a different color. Now, when I do this, I can see that the weld did penetrate down into the plates just a little bit along the legs on each side. However, down at the root, down at the very bottom of the weld, I don't really have penetration down into that joint. And so I'd like to see a little bit more. Now keep in mind, we're running beyond the capacity of the machine, and this is a technique that can possibly lend itself to having a little less penetration. So just know what you're getting, right? If you're building a barbecue, maybe it's fine. Wouldn't do it with a trailer hitch. Anyway, hopefully this was helpful to get you started with Flux Cored welding. If you learned something or enjoyed this video, let me know by hitting that thumbs up below. We'll see you next time.